an honor to be here at the Modern. Years ago, when I came to New York after graduating from art school, my first job was here at the Modern. And the Modern had such an impact on me, being able to study the collection every day, to go through the galleries and come to the education department and see the films by Duchamp and Man Ray, and to follow everything in the project galleries. So, you know, it's really nice. And the Modern's always had a very special place, you know, in my heart. But my work's really is based a lot from the collection. But we'll start. When I moved to New York, I was always a painter, and I always studied to be a painter from the time that I was a child. I started taking art lessons when I was probably about 7 years old, and the only thing I was really prepared to do was to be an artist. I wasn't prepared for anything else. I had my liberal arts background to go to college, but I spent all my time in the art class. And so I'm really fortunate that when I got to art school, because I had no understanding of what art could be, that I ended up in this profession that really can be a hub to all the disciplines in the world. And that I found this vehicle, because I had no idea what I was involved with, and I really don't today, but because art always transforms. But here was this vehicle that would connect theology and philosophy and sociology with physics and aesthetics, you know, just with, you know, kind of subjective dreams. And so it's wonderful every day to participate in this dialogue. When I got here, I stopped having interest in painting because I felt that it was too subjective. I always loved Dada and surrealism, but I really wanted more from my work. I wanted to connect with my generation and to make work that you know, was about things outside myself, not just about myself. So this is a piece called Inflatable Bunny with Inflatable Flower. And when I made this, I just would go out and buy these ready-made objects, very influenced by Duchamp and Robert Smithson. And, you know, I love different connections in art history because it feels a connection to humanity that way. But I felt within these pieces, though, that it was revealing a little bit too much of my own sexuality, the bright color. As time goes on, I come back and I like that aspect in the work. So, working here at the Modern and seeing a lot of the ready-mades and the design and architecture department, I started to make these works. This is my first Hoover, and it's called Hoover Celebrity 3. But the work's infringed upon, and there's actually bolts that go through the back of the vacuum cleaner. And so they're really being displayed, not in kind of any unique way. They're really actually quite, you know, in a modernist tradition, kind of a Mondrian background. And this was, so I felt that I wasn't really contributing to a Duchampian tradition. So I decided that I didn't want to infringe upon these objects. I didn't want to fight gravity. I didn't want to, you know, put a bolt through them or crazy glue something to another surface. So I just started to encase them. And I would display them really in a Renaissance type manner of sculpture. This is like an eternal virgin. So, and this is displaying its newness. It's a new Hoover convertible. And I would take it out of the box, keep everything clean and pristine, and put it inside this commercial kind of display situation, and it would just display its newness. This is a double-decker, a displaced double-decker, and, you know, kind of following the kind of the pop tradition of more is better, but I also like the type of vocabulary that would happen between the objects. They would start to develop, like, family relationships or, you know, kind of male-female relationships to each other. So the way they would communicate back and forth. The top vacuum cleaner says wet-dry at the top. It's a vacuum cleaner that you would use to also pick up liquids. But I also enjoyed Kierkegaard and Sartre and either-or being a nothingness. So when I make my tanks, I think that they relate a lot to the wet, dry, and the being a nothingness. After making the new, there was a time when my work really didn't have a lot of support in New York. So I had to really turn to have a profession that I could make enough money to produce my own works. The vacuum cleaner pieces would cost me about $3,000 each to make. So I ended up working on Wall Street, selling commodities and stocks and bonds, but I specialized in cotton. And I did that, and I ended up producing a body of work then called Equilibrium. And I was independent then of really looking for collectors, or I really wanted to be independent with my work where I wasn't reliant on anybody. So in 85, I made a body of work called Equilibrium, and I wanted it to be more kind of masculine, not because people would think of the vacuum cleaners as the feminine housewife in the 50s, and I wanted to show kind of a darker side of consumerism, kind of more male-oriented and more biological. One ball Equilibrium tank to me is very womb-like, and it's an ultimate state of being. All the forces are equal. It's equilibrium, and it's a pre-birth. It's a pre-new. I wanted the viewer to desire that, and I also wanted them to hear the sirens telling them to go for equilibrium in this exhibition. And this was Dr. Dunkenstein, and Dr. Dunkenstein was a siren in the equilibrium show that would basically kind of be like a star there saying, you know, I've achieved equilibrium, you know, go for it. And here he is with a, you know, a basketball that's exactly divided in half. It's a Nike poster. I also go on and I make these 50-50 tanks where exactly half the ball is submerged and half's above the water. And Ed Paschke, a teacher that I had and a friend, Ed always told me that everything's already here in this world and you just have to look for it. And my experience in art has always been one of just opening myself up to my environment and trying to keep everything in play. And I would just find that I could develop a narrative in between different objects, different images or ready-mades. This was a tool for equilibrium. So I had a tank that if you desired it, an ultimate state of being, a siren telling you to go for it, and then a tool was like the aqualung. And it was cast in bronze, and if you put the aqualung on to go for it, it would take you under and, you know, probably drown you. But if you were able to get the aqualung off your back and resurface and think you found salvation, there would be a lifeboat there, but it was made of bronze and would take you right back down. And I think that I was trying to say that white middle-class artists were using art for social mobility the way other ethnic groups have used sports for social mobility. And, you know, all these sirens kind of faking it like we've achieved something. And one of them could have been me. One of them could have been Polka. Could have been Julian. Could have been any artist. But we were really artists instead of the basketball players there as the sirens. This is a 50-50 tank. It's back to that wet-dry, either or. You know, due to vibration and even the sun will move these basketballs from one end of the tank to the other. And when that happens,